State Business Show brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. I'm your host, Harvey Freed, alongside of me, Mr. Harry Glanz.
The music's rocking this morning, Harvey.
Yeah, we're going to wake everyone up.
It's crazy.
Hey, Harry, we also brought in Brian Cohn from Capital Mortgage. Of course, hey, Brian, good morning.
Good morning, guys.
You could talk with Brian a little bit more about reverse mortgages, reverse mortgage purchases, and everything else about mortgages. And he brings in Mike Lucas from Remerica Hometown 3. Hey, Mike, thanks for joining us. Always nice to have a great real estate agent in here.
Thank you very much.
Hey, Harv, did you know that Brian is the only one in our office? We've designated him. He's the only certified reverse mortgage banker in our office.
I promise I'm going to fly out to Madison, Wisconsin, and learn all about it one day real soon. But right now, Brian's the expert.
I'm going to tell you, I'm going to tell you why we do it that way. We do it that way so somebody has a singular point of contact in our office. And that's extremely important because Brian's going to go over reverse mortgages. We have Brian on more than a few times here to explain the process because it's a better process. It's a, I don't want to say an easier process, Brian, but people have to be educated. This isn't like doing a regular forward mortgage, a regular 30-year amortized forward mortgage. There's a lot more education, counseling. Brian's in an advisory role, and that's why we have one person that's an expert in our office because you just can't. Unfortunately, the mortgage industry, there are so many people that say they're in the mortgage industry and think they're expert enough in it. The reverse mortgage situation doesn't work that way, does it, Brian?
Well, retirement is an important aspect of everybody's life. And when you're downsizing into a suitable home for your retirement, this is a product, the reverse mortgage, that can be used to buy a house. And a lot of times I'll talk to realtors, financial advisors, people that are retiring, and when you ask them, did you know that you could buy a house with a reverse mortgage? And I get, no, I didn't know that.
They're like, huh?
Right, you get the huh. And for them to not to know that, and when they're shopping for a house and they have that product at their disposal, and I'm sure Mike will talk about how people will be looking to downsize, but they're not down pricing. So they're moving from one house to another house that's more suitable to their needs, and they're cash buyers. And when you can keep 50% of that purchase price in their pocket and be able to live in that house for as long as they live, as long as either one of them is alive if they're married, with no mortgage payment, that increases your retirement dollar.
Yeah. But also it takes a lot of education. You have to walk somebody through this process. And not only, Brian, do you have to walk them through the process, but you have to walk through their errors through the process too. Because the one thing that when people get older and they reach a certain age, they, A, want to make sure their family's taken care of, but also, B, they want to enjoy the fruits of their labor and make sure that they're not going to run out of money when they get up in their retirement years.
Exactly. And the one point that I tell people is that when you're doing this, the one thing that you want to protect is your house. You want to make sure that you have a place to live that's suitable for your needs. You want to make sure that you have a place to live that you don't have a payment on. That's the best thing about having a house that's free and clear is not having a payment.
So
if you can keep, let's say, $150,000 in your nest egg and still have the house without a mortgage payment, that is a huge boon for your retirement. And that doesn't affect the heirs because you now have more money in what we separated into three buckets. You now have money in bucket two that would pass on to your heirs instead of a lot of people are taking, I've done I remember doing a mortgage for people 30-year fix at 70 years old.
Right.
You know, and now they're taking money out of their, whether it be Social Security, out of their pension, if they're lucky enough to have one, out of their savings to pay on a forward mortgage. That's depleting their assets.
Yeah, but let's not sugarcoat this, okay? Because this is the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate and Business Show. It used to be a reverse mortgage was a little dicey. This is not your reverse mortgage product of 8, 10, 12 years ago. This is different. There are more benefits to it. And, Brian, people are going to be skeptical because they're going to remember what happened 8, 10, 12 years ago. Why is this different than the previous reverse mortgage program?
There's a couple things. One thing is that you can buy it with a purchase, which is basically keeping money in your pocket and then getting the benefit of the reverse mortgage when you buy it. The second thing is, the industry used to give the money all at once, okay? So you'd go out and you'd get a reverse mortgage, and let's say you got qualified for $120,000. We'd give the money all at once. You know, and then what happens when that money goes? If you help out your kid, and then all of a sudden, and in a depreciating market.
What, you mean they go down to the casino, they put it on black, cover green, right, and roll it?
There was no, now there's a line of credit attached to it that's got an automatic growth factor. There's only a certain amount that you can take out in year one, which is a protection in terms of just kind of the you know, the boon of getting all this money, and then they act irresponsibly with it. So there's so many safeguards. The line of credit is the biggest thing, where it comes with a line of credit that's guaranteed to grow month over month, year over year, that increases that that savings for your retirement, and also the purchase program into it. So those are the two things that have kind of saved the program from being
sketchy.
And the loan of last resort.
You can say sketchy.
Okay, sketchy.
Good.
And also there is some qualification now where there wasn't before. So there is some type of there is a little bit more of an income qualification now where there wasn't before. Basically, before, you would get your leads from foreclosure lists, and you would basically
save dialing for dollars.
You'd be kicking the can down the road.
You don't want to do that.
Right. You'd just be kicking the can down the road.
Well, that wasn't setting up anyone for success either. And then, of course, it led to other things. Well, an interesting product to say the least. And we offer all these type of programs at Capital Mortgage. Funny, again, that's for our aging borrowers out there, 62 and above. Social Security and retirement.
We do it cautiously, like you said. We set people up for success, and that's why we have one person doing it, because we don't offer it through our, you know, our network of 65 individuals that we have at Capital and throughout the country, you know, that we're part of a bigger, larger organization. We have Brian that does it, and it has to be right for that person. So this is not a mass marketed product.
One thing that I'll say about the reverse mortgage industry, and like a lot of industries, for even now, we're our own worst enemy. Because I say, hey, do you know you can buy a house with a reverse mortgage? You know that there's a line of credit attached. Well, how many, you see these reverse mortgage ads, they never mention it.
Right.
They never mention it. You know, so it has to be, you have to educate yourself on the product. It may not be for you.
Yeah,
it may not be for you. It might not be the right fit for you, but you should know how it works as you enter retirement to see if it is an option for you.
Some of the same struggles that some of our younger buyers are dealing with, they have some debt and some college student loans that they have to deal with. Now, so on the other side, as we get older, we have the lack of income coming in. You know, you're debt heavy as younger, but then you have the lack of income coming in as you get older. And again, there's some different programs out there that help anyone at any age. And again, whether you're 62 or above and looking for retirement, or a first-time home buyer, there's some definitely tough market out there. Mike, we see this all the time. It's a tough market out there for young people, especially in today's marketplace. That price range between $75,000 on purchasing a home and about up to $250,000, you're competing with a lot of cash buyers.
Correct, and the market almost is non-existent right now with the inventory, as we all talk about on a daily basis. So there are a lot of tricks to try to get your offer accepted, and agents really need to work backwards, in my opinion, when they're working with these buyers. They need to really do their due diligence up front and figure out not only what the buyer's situation is, are they locally approved with the local lender, do they have the funds, do they need concessions, because in a large majority, those days are gone as far as concessions are concerned.
Yeah, that's a great point, and it's definitely been a hurdle for some of our buyers. You know, back in, if you just go back over the last 20 years, it's been really easy to potentially increase the sales price just a little bit. In other words, part of your negotiation would be to move the sales price up just a little bit and have the seller contribute seller's concessions.
Sure.
So it becomes a win-win, where the seller nets what they need out of the house, and now in today, and then of course the buyers are able to get in and close. But now with cash offers, there's no reason for a seller. They don't need to take an offer and pay $5,000 closing costs, where they'll sell the house for the same price with no concessions.
Rarely see it nowadays. I've had 17 closed transactions. I've had one concession this year. It just it's not something a seller needs to do. There's too many cash offers on the table. There's too many 20% conventional downs. There's too many free occupancies. There's so many things that the buyer's agent has started to understand what to do to align themselves to win, that the concession is a thing of the past at this point.
Yeah, Mike, I'm going to err on your side right now. I'm going to say this to you. I don't believe that there are, you know, all-encompassing statement. I don't believe there are many realtors loading people in their cars or meeting people at houses that haven't told their borrower that they need a pre-approval. Like you said, the market's too tight. It's a seller's market. Not a lot of concessions, not a lot of inventory. I'm going to say that in your industry, on your side of the transaction, there are very, very few, if any, people are working with people that aren't pre-approved now.
Correct. It's kind of crazy if you are. You have to have that done up.
Yep. You got to have that real strong approval letter. When we come back, that music tells us we're going to come back with tons of information. We're going to talk about a real approval letter, not just a pre-qualification, a real approval letter, setting yourself up so that you can close in 30 days and get your offer accepted. We'll be right back. Keep it here.
Hi, Harry Glanz and Dan Burke for Capital Mortgage Funding. We do loans everywhere. In Southfield, in Birmingham, in Royal Oak, in Groseal, in Detroit, in Canton, in Northville.
No matter where you live,
we want to do your mortgage too. That's Capital Mortgage Funding, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker.
Core Mortgage, Real Estate Business Show, brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. That's where you want to call and get a real approval letter, the approval letter that'll get your offer accepted. That's right, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. If you haven't refinanced, boy, John Kolb, are these interest rates, it's still at all-time lows, and so many opportunities out there for families to consolidate their debt. Again, all-time highs when it comes to equity, billions of dollars across the United States. Now's that still that opportunity, and if you have maybe an interest rate that you haven't refinanced yet, just by knocking down the term and consolidating debt, you could save hundreds and hundreds of dollars and really set yourself up for success moving forward. And we see so many also, John, families getting rid of the mortgage insurance, getting rid of PMI and MIP.
Oh, yeah. I can even just talk from a personal experience. You know, we just, after being in a loan for so many years, going from a 30-year to a 15-year, and with how good the rates are, it only increased my payment by $100 a month.
Favorite product.
Right.
Good job.
And now you're going to, I shaved 8 years off the loan. The payment only went up $100, and I'm going to pay it off sooner? Oh, all day long. Yeah.
Yes. So you saved hundreds of thousands of dollars doing that.
Yes.
In that 8 year
with
period of time.
With capital mortgage funding.
Oh, well, you did your own. There you go. I'm just saying, financially, it's a good move. You can go from a 30 to a 15 if you know you're going to be in the house. You know you're going to make that payment. You build the equity quicker. You're going to pay off the loan quicker. And people, you have to understand, when you take a mortgage out, the object is to pay it off.
Absolutely.
Right? Probably the worst mortgage guy in the world. I want everybody to have zero mortgages. Pay off your loan.
Yep.
Okay?
I agree.
And
we'll find another business of theirs. Everyone pays it off.
But people, you know, people's behavioral pattern, Harvey, that's never going to happen.
Let's just sit here. It's sort of a reminder of what went on. And, of course, you guys remember, Kevin, not too long ago, of course, in our industry, 2007, 8, and 9, there was a big-time recession.
$10 Triple Diamonds $2 Instant Game. Win up to $50,000. There's fun in every one. Plus, you can win tickets to see the Tigers, courtesy of Chevrolet, the official sponsor of the Detroit Tigers. Call 866-66-TIGER or visit Tigers.com for your tickets to any Tigers home game.
Download the all-new Radio.com app and listen to 97.1, The Ticket, anytime, anywhere. 97.1, The Ticket.
How to land the right house in a tough environment, that's for sure. This is the Hardcore Mortgage Show, brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. Give us a call at the office. Get that real approval letter. 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. Also, you'll deal with real mortgage professionals. Yeah, we're all experienced mortgage professionals. We can take you from A to Z on the transaction. That's what you want. You want to have professional people working with you, especially with this is probably the most expensive thing you're going to be purchasing in your life. And nothing could be better. That tax deduction is still, I think, the top reason why we see so many families wanting to get a piece of the housing industry. Why not? A chance to build some equity in your house. It's already been proven that homeowners typically are wealthier, and that, you know, it's a great place to start, and you have to have a roof over your head.
Well, since everybody survived tax week, you know, April, we got an extended day, Harvey. It was April 17th, and it went up to April 18th because the IRS website crashed or whatever happened there. But, you know, let's call it like we see it. Rates are going up. That's where they're going. People don't understand that. They're not going down. We said they weren't going down to zero. As a matter of fact, they are up, and they're going to continue to go up throughout the year. The Fed said they're going to go ahead and increase rates four times this year. They already did it once, so they're projecting to do it three more times. What does that mean? That means that regardless of what the market is doing out there, and you better find a home, because I'm projecting at this time rates are going to be higher next year than they are this year. But that's, you know, that's neither here nor there. If you find the property that you like, and Mike will tell you this, there's a shortage of inventory on the market, quality inventory and real inventory and volume, that you better make your move and you better be prepared. So before we went to the break, I said that I don't believe that agents are taking people out there that are not qualified. Mike, what do you say about that?
Correct. There's no reason to be showing houses to anybody without a pre-approval. And not only just a pre-approval, a really good one. You know, before I work with anybody, you know, I try to get them with a preferred lender that I've worked with, such as Brian, other lenders in the local area. Out-of-state lenders, just a no-no. That does not look good in front of a seller. It's got a stigma, as we know. And there are several ways for you to help your buyer win over heavy, heavy competition. Mm-hmm. So you really need to work backwards, in my opinion. You need to talk to them up front. The old days are gone where you just throw it to a wall and see if it sticks, because there's so much out there that you may only be the only offer and the seller has no choice but to accept your offer and give you concessions and whatever you want. It's complete opposite now. So now you have a situation where if you've got a 5% conventional buyer, that's no longer the strong buyer. Mm-hmm. I got to be honest with you. We don't see very many FHA 3.5% downs anymore. Hmm. Now it's a 3% or a 5% conventional. So there's a lot of things you can do to help your buyer push you over the top, push themselves over the top. And a lot of that comes down to tightening up closing dates. You know, the 45-day closing, again, thing of the past. You need to work with a lender and get it done in 30 days.
Well, let's talk about that. I want to interject here. If the seller has nowhere to go, why would you close in 30 days? There's an answer that you're going to give me, but why? What does it matter when you close? You have to gear that to the seller. Sometimes what we're finding out, Mike, that sellers want a longer occupancy or slash closing date. So what you're telling me is they want to close quicker but stay in the house and kind of hang out until they find a place.
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, shortening up the closing date really shows your eagerness to buy that home, as well as your earnest money deposit. If it's $1,000, it's again a thing of the past. People are putting $5,500 deposits down on a $200,000 house to show how serious they are, as well as that close by date. Also things like a gap letter, appraisal shortfalls. If there's an appraisal shortfall, mm-hmm. you know, they're going to willing to bring $5,000 above and beyond out of their pocket if they're bidding over in a bidding war. There's also other things that we're helping the seller out with, and that's backloading on the occupancy.
Right.
To your point, Harry, there's, you know, a lot of times we're giving 30, 60 days of occupancy. And furthermore, I've recommended on several occasions, knowing I'm going to have an exact same offer as someone else, that they don't charge occupancy rate.
Right.
Give it to them for free. that's $2,000 or $3,000 back in that seller's pocket, which could again push you over the top along with the other components of that offer.
So if I'm a seller of that house, and to recap what you said, if somebody's giving me $5,000-$10,000 down, they're giving me a 30-day close, they're letting me stay in the house 30 to 45 days, and they qualify and they have a pre-approval from a reputable lender, why wouldn't I take that offer?
Correct. You want to work backwards too. You want to reach out to that listing agent prior to submitting an offer and really find out what the real deal is. For all you know, that person has found a house already. You don't know that. Just because it says 60 days on the MLS ticket for occupancy, it doesn't mean that they found something. It also doesn't mean, like some of my listings, that the seller has chosen to just take a timeout.
Okay.
They're going to do a short-term rental for 6 months, or they're going to move in with family, and they're going to capitalize on the equity that they currently have and not miss the boat on what they're sitting on.
Such a strong point right there. Such a strong point. There's nothing wrong, okay, with vacating that property and moving into temporary housing, a month-to-month lease on an apartment, because you don't want to be pressured in to buying something that you don't want, but you want to capitalize on the current situation in the seller's market, take the money. If you can find someplace temporary to live, go for that, and then don't be pressured in. That's an excellent point, Mike.
Yeah, everyone's got
really
a little bit.
Appreciate that. That's a great point.
I agree. And I think a lot of, we were talking about inexperienced real estate agents. They get a listing. They're not looking at the second part of the equation. They're not looking, you know, selling the house right now is happening quick. As you said, and they're not looking at part two, and they're not planning that seller for part two of the equation, which is then buying. And Harry and you guys bring up a great point where selling the house is great and you do capitalize on your equity. It doesn't necessarily always mean that you have to rush into buying your next property and then being put on the spot of having to chase down a house that either it's not priced the way you want it to, and you're kind of say, I've got to buy something. So I think that's a great point in saying that you can sell, but you don't necessarily have to buy right away. You can go 6 months to a year renting and kind of pick your spots.
Hey, we have open lines all morning long here on the Hardcore Mortgage Show. Again, brought to you by Capital Mortgage Funding. Call the office, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. Here live in the studio, 248-539-9797. Always great to have a great agent in. Mike Lucas with Remerica.
Mike's smart.
Yeah, Mike, he's got a family. He's, you know, your dad was in real estate. We're going to get to all your biography, you. Mike. You're definitely
Mike's
extremely
rolling.
Well qualified. But, Mike, one of the things you mentioned, too, I mean, March Homes numbers came out. Prices were up 8.9%. However, that is the highest in the last 4 years. Lack of homes sold down 11.9% because of the lack of inventory out there from March of 2017. But one of the things that was sort of stood out to me is homes sold in March, 23.9% of them sold over asking price. So there it is right there. 23, almost a quarter of the homes are selling over asking price. So you are going to find yourself in these bidding wars. It typically takes a little bit of extra money. And one of the things we wanted to reach out to help some of the buyers out there is you might need to reach out to your parents and or uncle and start talking about some gift letters. Also start talking about the funds that you have to work with. It's very important that you set yourself up so that you're ready to close on a transaction. And again, if something goes different in the transaction, you need a little bit of extra money to make up the difference. Like you said, you had some appraisal issues. Obviously, as people are overbidding on these great houses, they don't want to miss out on it.
So, Brian, Mike, and Harvey, I'm going to jinx myself right now.
Uh-oh.
Okay, Mike, this question is directed to you. So, lately, I haven't had any appraisal rebuttals. Okay, property values, right? Appraisal rebuttals, I haven't had any. I've had two, okay? Maybe in the last 2 weeks. So, Mike, here's the situation. Now, spring has sprung. It's nice outside. What's going to happen when you get a low appraisal? It's going to happen because people are just bidding it up. And appraisers, they're not obligated to bring it to sales price. They're obligated to bring it in at what they feel the value is based on the comparable sales of like properties in the subject area. If Tom Check's listening, he'll be proud that I said it that way. So what happens when you get that? You have the house listed for $250. It comes in over. You got a purchase agreement at 260 and the house comes in at 250 value. What do you do?
It's inevitable. Right now, I agree with you. Knock on wood, the appraisals have not been a major issue last 90 days, I would say. But again, it's inevitable with these skyrocketing prices and the competition. One of the things I do as a listing agent is I really need to set that expectation with my seller. You know, the highest comp in your neighborhood is 250. You've got this, this, and this. You've done to the house. We will put it on the market for $257,900. and see what we have. You're not doing your seller a service if you do not try to capitalize on the seller's market and try to get every dollar for them. But you need to set that expectation, as they may have to drop that or meet them in the middle on that price if it does not appraise. And there's other solutions, obviously.
Always a starting point, for sure. Great stuff. Hey, we got tons to share with you here. Just getting started. Come on back and join us. 248-539-9797.
Hi, Harry Glanz and Dan Burke for Capital Mortgage Funding. We do loans everywhere. In Southfield, in Birmingham, in Royal Oak, in Groseal, in Detroit, in Canton, in Northville. No matter where you live, we want to do your mortgage too. That's Capital Mortgage Funding, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker.
Alrighty, welcome back. We're in our last segment here. Keep it on 97.1 all day. We got Tiger Baseball coming up at 2:10. Jim and Dan with the call. It's going to be exciting stuff for sure. Of course, we got Pat Caputo coming up with sports right after us. 248-539-9797. We'll take all your calls here on the Hardcore Mortgage Real Estate Business Show.
Pistons won last night.
All right, we got good things. Got the last Red Wing game down at Little Caesars Arena tonight. Get down there if you haven't checked out the arena. The Wings are going to be pushing around the Islanders, hopefully. That'll be good news. And, of course, we got a lot more of real estate here with Kevin Stewart. Kevin, it's some calls to get to. Let's actually go out to Todd in Commerce. Hey, Todd, you're talking about the process of buying a home. You need some advice. Go ahead. Tell me some of your questions.
Yeah, good morning. Hey, we're in the process of closing on a home. We sold our house in 2 weeks. We're actually closing on our home. It's an older home that was remodeled. We had it inspected. I'm concerned about it's on a well, septic.
Yes.
And talked with my agent. We've gone through the inspection process. My gut is telling me more and more to actually get the well inspected by a certified well inspector. I just wanted to kind of know if we find something, my agent said we can't go back to the seller. What are my legal ramifications if we do find some issues with the well when we're in this late stage of the game with buying this home?
Well, you can definitely fix it. It could be a chlorinating of the well. Sometimes that's one of the problems that comes up on the well. So, again, you said the seller, but you meant the buyer.
Well, we're not attorneys, and we don't play them on the radio, so you probably need to seek legal counsel on that. However, if you have in your contract, I don't know how far you are in, did you have a contingency that if the well wasn't in operation that you could go ahead and cancel a transaction?
No.
Okay, so I mean, I'd have to read the contract again. I would tell you you should call a real estate attorney and have them look at the contract. How much earnest money deposit did you put down?
$5,000.
So you put down $5,000. In the contract, does it say if you don't perform, you lose the $5,000?
Yes.
Well, that could be an answer. So how much is it going to cost?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, that could be an answer, but not the answer. It could be an answer. How much is it going to cost you to get the well fixed?
Well, he doesn't know yet.
Right,
Todd?
Well, I don't know yet. I just want to get it inspected.
All right, absolutely.
I'm playing devil's advocate.
Yeah, call the county. I would just call Oakland County.
I would.
Brought to you by Twin Peaks. Tigers split a Twinble yesterday, winning the opener 3-2 in a 10th inning walk-off solo homer by Jacoby Jones, losing the nightcap 3-2 on a Nico Goodrum error. Today they tried again, 3rd of 4 with the Royals of Comerica Park, 110 right here on 97.1 The Ticket. Michigan's Charles Matthews entered the NBA draft, not hiring an agent though, so he still has the option to stay in school. Stanley Cup playoff results, Flyers over the Penguins 4-2, Pittsburgh still leads it 3-2. Jets say goodbye to the Wild. They eliminate them with a 5-0 score. Bill Peters resigns as Carolina's head coach. NBA notes, Golden State Steph Curry out at least another week with a knee. Pacers over the Cavs 92-90. Cavs trail at 2-1. Celtics still with a 2-1 lead over the Bucks, but the Bucks whipped them last night 116-92. Ditto for the Raptors leading the Wiz 2-1, but the Wizards spanked them 122-103. At the Ticket Update Desk, I'm Jeff Lesson. For more, 97.1theticket.com.
97.1. push the sports button. 97.1 The Ticket.
Welcome back to the show, 9:33. If you're just joining us, gorgeous day out there, and you want to definitely get that approval letter if you thinking about owning a house, call Capital Mortgage, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. Also here live in the studio at 248-539-9797. We got lots to share with you here. And going into our second hour, of course, we brought Mike
Lucas. How about those Tigers?
What do you think? I'm all jacked up about it. I'm looking forward to a good weekend.
They're young. They're fun. They're running. They're stealing bases.
They're hitting home runs. Check back with you in July here and see how we're doing.
Cutoff men, but it's okay. They're all good. It's all good. It's what you do when you play baseball. You throw the ball around the yard. You run. You hit gaps.
You have to shake off that loss.
You make plays. You get excited.
Yeah.
You're sliding head first. We're doing things. We're rolling. I like it. What's wrong with that?
Sounds great. No, I love it too. Definitely, come on. Some good vibes here in Detroit. And if you guys want to talk about some debt consolidation, one of the things we haven't dove into yet, and I'll go to that before we get into back to purchases, of course, is consolidating your debt and using that equity in your house. Of course, refinancing has been the way to go. If you haven't taken a look at refinancing your mortgage, there's a lot of reasons why you would refinance. If you haven't taken a look at maybe reducing the term, that would be number one. After that, using the equity in your house to consolidate your debt and, of course, pay off some bad things out there, some of your toxic debt. Of course, Harry just mentioned it was tax season, and if you haven't paid Uncle Sam, that's another reason. Take a look at all the different options you have to get yourself really set up for your financial security moving forward. There's so many times that the mortgage can help you, and before you get into trouble, don't call us when it's too late. Don't call us after you start making late payments and stuff like that.
It's you know, it's refinancing. We like to help people, and we set people up for success, and it has to be because it's going to save you money or make your cash flow on a monthly basis better or pay off toxic debt. We're not refinancing just to refinance the loan. We're not throwing you into a one-year ARM, a three-year ARM when you're going to be in your house long-term. That's just not what our style is. We don't do that. And for that matter, there are a lot of great reasons to refinance now. Equity's at an all-time high if you do have that toxic debt, but out to dinner with a bunch of people last night. Mm-hmm. Here's the bottom line with refinancing. If you're going to pay off toxic debt, you have to throw out those credit cards. You have to close the account, tear up the credit cards, and never go back there again. Because all you're doing is using your house as a cash register. If you go ahead and you pay it off and you keep charging and charging and charging, that's not what the intent, at least that's not what we do it for. I can't speak for other lenders. Ultimately, it's up to the consumer, but we want to set you up for success for the long term. So,
well, we always say,
if you do it the right way and it's prudent, like you said, one thing that I'll tell people when they're considering a refinance cash out to pay off debt is your debt's not going away, but your equity may.
That's right. There you go. Well, that's inevitable, right? it's that scale. Okay, one's going up, one's going down. If you choose to go ahead and cash in your equity, which there's nothing wrong with that, it's a good long-term play if you don't charge on the same credit cards or different credit cards.
Right, but your equity right now is at an all-time high, but in 2 years, that equity could go away. You could lose $25,000, $30,000 in equity.
We've seen it. It's happened before.
We've seen more than that.
Right? We've seen that.
Well, call us for a one-on-one consultation. That's the key, is to get educated on the entire process. Understand what your options are. I mentioned it a little bit before, talking about maybe even getting some help from family members. It's really important, especially we've had some calls lately on families looking to purchase homes in the college towns. We've got a lot of great college towns here across Michigan and the United States, and these are great investment opportunities, but more so, the cost of living for your kids to go away to college. We've had a lot of families call us and go ahead and purchase homes in East Lansing, and of course, in the Ann Arbor area, just to use the bigger schools around here, whether it be at Eastern, Ypsilanti, and any of these schools are the Kalamazoo area. Great opportunities across Michigan and all around the United States. So different opportunities out there. If your kids are going to live in the house, they can even go on the mortgage with you, and they don't have to qualify. You can just qualify on your own. They can be co-signers. So there's a three or four different things that were cool when I went over it with a gentleman this week. Again, these are buying homes for your kids in college. I said, if you put the kids on the loan, a whole bunch of good things can happen. Bad things can happen too, but good things that can happen is they can build some equity up. They also can save money. They can use the home to rent it out to other students at the university. But also by having the child's name on there, whether your kid's 19, 20, or 21 years old, they don't wreck it. They don't treat the house like it's a fraternity house. And because their name's on it, they start understanding and respecting the investment and that they're going to own something down the road. So a lot of great things. Not only that, but you can build some credit up that way for your children. So, again, take a look at it. If you've taken Harry, as you know, you've gone through it. The cost of college tuition is one thing, but then the room and board is the other part of it.
Yeah, well, also I would tell you that that's what the biggest factor in people buying homes right now is. Singular biggest factor that's preventing people from buying a home is their student loan. Student loan debt is at an all-time high. So when we qualify somebody, and of course we do homes in all spectrums, okay, as we said at the onset of the show, if anybody was listening at the beginning of the show, we talk about homes in the $75,000 price range, $80,000 price range, $100,000 price range. It doesn't matter to us, okay, but we want to put you in a home that you're going to be successful paying off the loan, because the obviously the objective when you take out a loan is to pay it off and pay it down. All right, so we want to set people up, so we will qualify you on a $75,000 to $100,000 house. Of course, $125,000, something it you know, we people think that we just do $300,000 homes. That's not true. It can't be true, because we've been doing homes in this market for the last almost 30 years.
Right.
We run the gamut. And I see Mike over there shaking his head. Mike, your area of expertise is probably in the Livonia area. All over metropolitan Livonia, Canton, everything. There's price ranges from, you know, from 50 to, in that area, $500,000. Okay. Right. The average mortgage that we do, okay, believe it or not, and we do a lot of loans. Everybody thinks it's high. Our average balance is in the $170,000, $180,000
range. It's starting to tick up a little bit.
Okay, it's only gone up because the price of homes has gone up, okay? And when we talked about it at the beginning of the show, FHA loans, you know, we do rural development loans, FHA loans, we do VA loans. I mean, we do things that require a low down payment to try to help people get in a house as economically as possible. We're about keeping the cost down. So anybody out there that thinks that we're not doing that, I just can't believe that.
Mike, did you want to jump in with anything about any of your great listings out there? Just tell me what's going on. If you had some listings out there, give me a what's going on as a listing and selling agent. You're in the trenches every day. Oh, it's just...
Yeah, it's crazy. If you were a listing agent, for example, I put one up on the market, a quad in Canton, less than 24 hours ago. I have 31 showing requests on it.
A quad level?
Yep.
Okay.
Beautiful quad. I sold it to a young... 225. Sold it to a young couple 2.5 years ago for 180.
Wow.
I received a over asking price 4 hours into the listing with a gap letter guaranteeing, and I advised them not to take it. And the reason being, it wasn't strong in the other components. It was a low down payment. I had a strange feeling that it was someone that was throwing it to a wall to try to blow everyone out of the water and cancel my open house. And sure enough, six hours later, they pulled the offer from the table. So had I accepted that offer, I would put my people at a disposition by or
disadvantage.
Yeah. They would have been back on the market, and the next buyer may have thought something was wrong with that house.
Explain what a gap letter is.
A gap letter is basically a buyer saying, and I will guarantee I will bring X amount of dollars above and beyond an appraisal shortfall, not to exceed the purchase price that I'm offering. So if they offer 230 on a 225 and the appraisal comes in at 220 and they've given you a $5,000 gap letter, the PA then reverts back to a $225,000 sale.
Right.
They'll bring an additional amount of cash, which is great.
Yeah.
You know? But you have to be wary as a listing agent to stay away from the certain offers that, you know, when there's smoke, there's fire. The first offer used to be your best offer in this business, and not so much anymore. You have to, the highest is no longer the best.
I don't have a problem. One of the things you said, though, I'm not 100% on, and that is the down payment, because we have so many families out there. As Harry mentioned, the student loans are, you know, people have X amount of dollars they're working with
because
of the cost of living. Yeah, and VA zero down is a strong loan. We close in less than 30 days. FHA loans, I was ready to close on one in 18 days. So we closed in 24. I don't see any difference in my 26 years, whether a client, again, a strong buyer is a strong buyer that can close in 30 days regardless. But I think what we're seeing now, and I think what you're trying to say a little bit more is, if the communication's there on a lower down payment, that's the key, is that you get the call, you're able to call, even the mortgage banker can call and say, hey, I want you to know I signed the approval letter, we've already run this through, they've already documented their funds to close, we can close in 30 days. That's a stronger low down payment.
Great example as a VA.
What Mike's saying, though, is that if he's got three offers in front of him, one's a zero down, one's a 3% down, one's a 20% down, and then the rest of the terms are basically the same,
you got to think about the appraisal.
Yeah.
You know, the 20% down appraisal is usually going to be better and easier.
Yeah.
But also, they have a little flexibility when the guy's putting 20% down and the appraisal comes in a little bit less.
Right. Then you don't have to worry about it because he's got the money to put down.
All right.
I agree with that.
We got tons to share with you at 9:42. If you're just joining us here on the Hardcore Mortgage Show, we're going to be back.
248-539-9797.
Hi,
Hi, Harry Glanz and Danberg for Capital Mortgage Funding. We do loans everywhere. In Southfield, in Birmingham, in Royal Oak, in Groseal, in Detroit, in Canton, in Northville. No matter where you live, we want to do your mortgage too. That's Capital Mortgage Funding, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker.
Welcome back to the show, 917. We cannot say it's one of those great days, Dave McLean, to go out there and look at a house, but you definitely got to get your approval letter first.
Definitely be able to check for a leaky roof today. Okay. Or a leaking basement.
Always positive.
Today, out there. But if you are out there today, you're serious. Absolutely. If somebody lets you in their house to show the house, they're serious about selling it. If you're out there, you're serious about buying it.
Correct.
Take your shoes off.
And Dave's serious about working. Let's face it.
Take your shoes off at the door for sure. Definitely get that approval letter first. Sit down with a real mortgage professional, Capital Mortgage Funding, 1-800-LOW-RATE. You're going to find a full staff all weekend long. And that's the thing. We'll give you that opportunity. It's all about knowledge, education, and setting yourself up to be a successful homeowner. And that's the key about it. Let's move off to Mike Tomchek, who called in. Mike, thanks for taking the time this morning. We're going to, thank you. Got you on the board, too. Hey, Mike, good morning. Welcome to the show. Mike, you there?
Hello, Mike.
Oh, you can plug him in here. We'll try.
In regard to...
Oh, there you are.
A conversation you're having about shortage of inventory?
Yes. Yeah, let's go.
All right, beautiful. Great topic for right now. I wish Alex was there right now. He loves to say that there's not a shortage of inventory, that there's a shortage of good inventory.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to go ahead and say that's not accurate right now. There is a pure shortage of inventory right now.
I completely
agree. The last, I would say, probably 7 or 8 appraisals I've done, we're looking at maybe 1 or 2 for sale. And 24 or 25 sold in what I would define as the market area for the particular subject.
Right.
What that's leading to, and this is the main part of the topic is, and you guys can address this once I'm off the phone with the real estate agents there, is tons of offers over list price and consequently also over market value.
Right.
Okay. Getting tons of them here. I just simply wanted to point out on the appraisal side of it, you guys can buy a house for whatever you want out there, but do not think that the appraisal value is necessarily going to come in. And also, I get this comment all the time. You're telling me that they cannot buy it for that, you know, X amount of money. No, I'm not telling you that. You could buy it for $1 million if you want to. I'm just suggesting to the lender that they not lend on that amount of money.
Right.
Great point.
So let's go over this a little bit slower so everybody understands out there.
Okay.
A lender is going to lend on what you bring the value in on. If a house, just say, is up for sale and it's a $300,000 listing and there are multiple offers and somebody decides they're going to pay $300,000, for purposes of this conversation, $315,000.
Anywhere.
Welcome back, 946. And is it nice outside? Spring is here. That's right, 2018. Capital Mortgage Funding is the place to call. 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker. We're local. You're going to save a ton of money and deal with real mortgage professionals. It's the place to go to. I'll tell you that.
Hey, Harvey, did I ever tell you this?
Tell me.
You've got 26 years of experience. Brian across the desk here has over 20.
Okay.
I remember when I hired him at the Village, the former Village place, we sat down.
Right.
Yeah, well, interview went like this.
You've done this for 30.
So you're recommended by, and he gave me the guy's name. Yeah. I go, oh, you play golf? He goes, yeah. I go, you're hired.
Okay.
Anyways.
He's been a good guy to have on a scramble.
Yeah. I've got 4 decades of mortgage experience. Think about it. When Gordie Howe played, you know, he started, and they said he had 4 decades. So I started the mortgage business in the 80s. So if you go 80s, 90s, 2000, 2010s, right, that's 4 decades.
4 decades, just
any
like Gordie.
Any way you want to count it.
I like the analogy.
And look at Mike. Mike's experienced, knowledgeable. I love his, he's got great experience. He has great insight, and he makes some phenomenal points.
It's in his blood.
Pretty smooth. Grew up in the business.
Pretty smooth show. Correct. It's in his blood, right?
Hey, we'll take your calls at 248-539-9797. Let's move off to Richard. Richard, you've got an interesting question. You said, is there such things or these bidding wars? Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I was just curious.
last night we placed an offer on a house in Chesterfield Township. Their asking price was $181,500.
Mm-hmm.
We offered $181,500 with no concessions.
Yes.
We put $5,000 down.
Yep.
And they came back and said that there's four offers.
Right, and they're going to put you one of those highest and best, Mike. We hear that quite a bit, Richard. And, Mike, you want to comment on that? What's his next step? Yeah. Richard, what are you being – let me ask you this first, Richard. What are you being told is your next step?
That there's going to be, a bidding between, they're going to take the highest best offer.
Right. Right. Do you have an escalation clause?
We're qualified for $250,000.
Mm.
I mean, we have $23,000 to put down. My wife really liked the house, so I'm just trying to weigh my option as to what's a stronger offer.
Well, what did you offer? And Mike's going to ask this question. Did you offer any free occupancy after close?
We didn't, no. I mean, we sold our house, but I sold it to my sister.
Well, that's irrelevant.
We're still living in our house. My sister has her lease until October.
Mike, go ahead. Do you still need to close on your house? Is there a contingency on that or no?
No, it's closed. We've already...
Very good.
We've already closed that out.
One of the other things you need to consider is market value versus appraisal value. So don't be afraid to go over asking if the house is completely updated, needs nothing. If it doesn't need anything for 5 years, don't be afraid to overpay for it if you're going to be there, because you're not going to care in 5 years whether you paid $181,500 or $183,500.
Right.
The other thing to do is start pulling at the heartstrings of the sellers if you have to. Write a letter regarding your family. Don't be afraid, again, of that gap letter, free occupancy.
Escalation clause.
Yeah,
I'll put that in right away.
$1,000 over of the best bona fide offer. There's things like that you can do.
Okay.
So get with your agent and try to tighten up that offer to where you look superior.
So Mike, the agent here, and Mike, the agent has to go in and start selling. They've got to put this person's offer in the forefront. They've got to start doing some things. They have to sell this offer hard. That's just the way it is.
You're right.
Okay.
Mike, I have a question for you. And this, how much does you knowing the listing agent play into
huge
insurance? It's a big thing.
One of the things a good listing agent does when they receive an offer that they are potentially moving forward with, they'll look up the agent's production, unfortunately. It's just part of the what I do. I look up their experience or production and not necessarily use that against them or judge them by it, but I want to know what we're getting into, because I represent the seller and I want that road to be as smooth as possible and keep them away from all the BS that's involved in this business, the emotion. Yeah.
Well, you're looking for all the advantages you can.
Correct.
Put your offer at the highest and best, okay? So, you have to sell. This is a sales job. Right? When you're a realtor, it's a sales job. You have to sell the other side and why your offer is better.
You have to find the seller's hot point. It may be extended occupancy.
Absolutely.
It could be just the price, and that escalation clause will get them that house. A little bit of work to do. Again, it's not like the olden days. You dropped off the purchase agreement, and that was it. If that's the case, then Mr. and Mrs. Realtor, you're going to be back on the road with that buyer looking at several homes, and this is going to come up. You mentioned actually at the break, we're going to go to, let's go to Ray now, and we'll mention a little bit of strategy that we were talking about. Hey, Ray from Wyandotte, welcome to our show. Go ahead.
Hey, how you doing, sir?
Real good, Ray. Go ahead with your question. Keep that radio down. Go ahead.
Okay, hold on. I'm cutting the radio down right now. Yeah, my question is that I'm a current student, and I have my credit is decent, but me and my wife is trying to get a house. I was wondering, is there any type of programs that can help us get a house? Because I have a debt to income ratio with student loans, but I'm currently in school, and I will get the job I need to pay, to do what I need to, but I'm still having that debt to income ratio problem.
Yeah, there's no doubt it's key that you get the debt-to-income ratio down. You could look at a co-signer now. Again, in the future, if you were able to bring a family member on board to co-sign for you, you could own the house now at today's prices. Today's interest rate will be all locked in. And save that money, and then as you graduate, of course, now you have your full-time job, and then maybe consider removing that person from the mortgage down the road. But it becomes a numbers game, Ray, and if you consider that, is there anyone that would maybe co-sign for you, or you just need to maybe wait until you get that full-time job out of school?
See, I'm probably just going to have to wait until I get, but the market is, I want a house now, but you're right, I might have to just wait.
Yeah, sometimes in today's competitive market, we love to definitely put families into homes and people into homes, but sometimes it's just a matter of getting your ducks in a row first.
Ray, you touched on a good point, Harvey, but Ray, one thing you want to do is you want to see You'll have a good idea of what your job's going to be. You want to see what you will qualify that. You want to be prepared so that when you get that, you know what you can and can qualify for. Maybe when you get that job, you may have to spend, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6 months paying down a little bit some other debt in order to qualify. But you want to have a strategy down. You want to be prepared and know ahead of time what it's going to entail for you to buy a house.
All good stuff. Hey, we'll definitely follow up with you, Ray. It's a great call, and thank you for calling in here. Appreciate that.
All right, thank you. I appreciate you.
All righty. All right, hey, you know, let's move off to Blake real quick out in Newport. Good morning, Blake. This came up last week. We were talking about that. A gift of equity between family members is a great way to buy a house. Go ahead with your question.
Yes, I'm buying a house for my sister, and the house is worth $180,000, and I'm buying it for $140,000. She's giving me some equity. Why can't I use that equity as the down payment?
Well, you can. Absolutely, you can. Yeah, you 100% you can. Not only that, she can also pay for closing costs and prepaid items, setting up the escrow account and paying all your closing costs. So you could pretty much purchase that house with absolutely nothing out of pocket. And another question, have you lived in that house already?
Yeah, I live there now. I've been there about 6 months.
That's great. She's got 20% gift of equity. If you qualify for a conventional mortgage, you'll avoid a whole bunch of bad things, and you'll be really setting yourself up. No mortgage insurance at all on that.
Yeah, my wife wants to go through her credit union, and they're telling me I have to have a down payment. I don't like that.
I 100% hey,
Blake,
can tell you.
Harvey will give you a call after the show. There's no way.
Yeah, you're just dealing with inexperienced people, and we'd love to have you on as a client. So I look forward to calling you right after the show. Hey, thanks a lot, Blake. We'll get you in the office this week. Had that same call, Harry, last week. Thanks for the call, Blake. Had the same call last week.
Lisa Lawson was phenomenal.
Yeah, Lisa was great. I have a family. The girl's already coming in. She's bringing in her father. We're going to write up all the purchase agreements. We've already showed them how to do this. And I'm sorry to say that there's some local institutions that may not,
I don't fault them. They don't know what they don't know.
They just don't know what they don't know. Fair enough. That was a nice way of saying it.
Then they're disseminating inaccurate versus accurate information. You know, I have a problem with that.
Harry,
inaccurate information versus accurate information kills me every day.
You won't allow me to slam on credit
unions. No, do not slam.
Okay, so I won't say anything. We'll move off to Mike here. Mike, one of the things we were talking about before, too, is it's always the best offer. It's not always the highest amount isn't always the best offer, as you mentioned. Just sort of touch on that a little bit for families out there.
Absolutely. It's a combination. If you're a listing agent and you've got a really hot listing, you need to prepare yourself for what's about to happen around the corner. Typically, I like to list houses on a Thursday with an open house advertised 1 to 4 on Sunday, and half the time I don't get there. I do not do previews. If I have a coming soon ad, I will not allow anybody in there on a preview basis. I've been burned on that too many times. But one of the things that you need to work with your sellers on is factor in what they've done to the house versus what you believe the comps are, because there's nothing wrong with putting that a little bit higher than you're pushing the market is what we're doing right now. And the other thing is to educate them. Do not let them have an elevated thought of what they're going to get, because everyone knows it's a seller's market. Do not let them be unrealistic, or you will let them down.
False expectations are always no good.
Absolutely. You have to be the professional. You have to educate them, and don't let them tell you, well, I paid $180 for it or $185 for it 2 years ago or 3 years ago or 5 years ago. That's irrelevant. It's about what it's worth today.
Yeah, definitely get your credit all figured out. There's
Wait
so
a minute,
many
where are we going?
Here. That's it already. Here,
where
Harry,
are we going?
I
That's
gotta send
it?
Out, Harry, I got to send out some thank
Look
yous
at the guys
here.
Behind the glass. What are you guys doing?
They're doing great.
We got to go?
Harry, I got to throw this out there real quick. My guy hooked me up, Matt Harris. You're unbelievable out at Westbourne Chrysler and Dearborn on Michigan Avenue. Matt Harris, good. Awesome job. It was fun to work with you this week.
We got 4 minutes left.
Hey, Harry, they want us to go. Brian Cohn, thank you for coming in
Thanks
and filling
for
in
me.
For our extra loan officer.
Bye, everybody.
Nothing like having the great Mike Lucas from Remerica Hometown 3. Mike, we're going to get you back on. You're awesome. If you need
Appreciate
a great
it.
Agent, be sure to call Capital Mortgage Funding. Get that approval letter. We'll set you up with all these great agents all across Southeast Michigan. All right, tons of sports. Keep
Go
it here
Tigers.
On 97.1 all weekend long. We got the Tigers coming up at 1 o'clock. All right, for Harry Glanz, Brian Cohn, I'm Harvey Freed. See you next Saturday. 97.1, the ticket.
Hi, Harry Glanz and Dan Berg for Capital Mortgage Funding. We do loans everywhere. In Southfield, in Birmingham, in Royal Oak, in Groseal, in Detroit, in Canton, in Northville. No matter where you live, we want to do your mortgage too. That's Capital Mortgage Funding, 1-800-LOW-RATE, the best mortgage banker.